Lending and borrowing are one of the major aspects of any financial system. At some point, you may have utilized these options yourself, either by taking a loan or by putting money in a savings account. In this video, we'll look at how lending and borrowing works in DeFi, compare this with how it works in traditional finance or CeFi, advantages of using DeFi lending, and finally, risks of using DeFi to lend or borrow. A quick side note before we get started. If you have any questions along the way, leave it in the comments below and I'll be happy to answer them. Also, in this channel, I'll cover the technical aspects of blockchain technology in simple terms without any hype, FUD or price targets. If this is something you'd be interested in, hit that subscribe button and now let's dive into DeFi. To gain some context, let's begin by looking at how lending and borrowing works in traditional finance. In CeFi, we use banks or crypto apps such as BlockFi, Celsius, and Nexo. We need to open a verified account and deposit fiat or cryptocurrencies into these accounts. The services will pool all deposits and lend them out to other users or institutions for interest. And finally, a portion of the interest generated is paid to the depositors. While this seems straightforward, there are several drawbacks and risks such as limited accessibility. The services require KYC verifications, and even then, available only for people living within certain countries. Scope for mismanagement. Since these companies are often at liberty to lend funds how they see fit, this can lead to mismanagement and taking riskier bets with users' money. Target for attacks. Central systems often become a huge target for hacks and exploits. In the event of a major hack, the company may not be able to repay its depositors. Now, let's look at how DeFi protocols facilitate these services without any intermediaries. In this video, I'll be using Aave and Compound for reference implementations. These are currently the two most popular protocols for DeFi lending. In the CeFi system, each user has an account. The bank uses this account to keep track of users' deposits and accumulating interest. DeFi protocols take a slightly different approach. They issue specialized tokens that serve as a proxy for users' deposits and accumulating interest. Aave uses A tokens and Compound uses C tokens. You'll see more about how these tokens work and their advantages in the next sections. Lending can be viewed as making a deposit and accumulating interest over time. Let's look at DeFi lending using an example. Say you have 2 Ether in your wallet and you want to earn interest on it. The lending protocol maintains a separate market for each token they support. These are called money markets. Anyone can lend or borrow funds from these markets. So, you will deposit your ETH into Compound's Ether market. In return, the Compound protocol will send CETH tokens into your wallet. The exact quantity of the CETH tokens you get depends on the exchange rate between CETH and ETH. Say the exchange rate at the time of your deposit is 1, meaning you will get 2 CETH for your deposit of 2 ETH. You can at any time withdraw your ETH from this market by exchanging it for CETH. Now, as people borrow ETH from this market and pay back with interest, the amount of ETH in this market increases over time compared to the CETH issued for deposits. This is reflected by increasing the exchange rate. So, in a few months' time, the exchange rate could be 1.1 ETH per CETH, meaning the 2 CETH you received is now worth 2.2 ETH. The exchange rate numbers used in this example are purely for the sake of simplicity. The actual current exchange rates look something like this. The idea is that just by holding these specialized tokens in your wallet, you'll be accumulating interest over time. The interest is reflected in the form of an ever-increasing CETH to ETH exchange rate. The rate is updated for each Ethereum block, so you are essentially generating interest about every 13 seconds. Borrowing is basically taking a loan. When you take a loan, you're typically required to provide collateral. This protects the lenders in the event the borrower defaults on the loan. In traditional finance, you can take loans which are over-collateralized, under-collateralized, or even uncollateralized. Currently, DeFi protocols only support over-collateralized loans. One exception to this are flash loans, which let you borrow an unlimited amount of money without any collateral. I will cover flash loans in another video, so for now, let's limit ourselves to over-collateralized loans in DeFi. If loans are over-collateralized, You may ask, why would I borrow instead of just selling my assets? Well, selling your assets means you will miss out on any future gains on that asset. By borrowing, you are able to obtain capital without selling your assets. And also, you can avoid capital gains tax. Now, suppose you are holding Ether for the long term and you need USDC to pay for an unexpected expense. You can borrow USDC against the value of your Ether. To do this, first you need to deposit your collateral token with a lending platform such as Compound. Using our earlier example, say you deposited 2 ETH and you received 2 CETH into your wallet. Now, you can use that CETH to borrow from Compound's USDC market. The amount you can borrow is limited by the collateral factor. If the collateral factor for ETH is 75%, it means you can borrow up to 75% of the value of your CETH in USDC. The collateral factor can be different for each asset. There are also other factors that could affect how much you can borrow, such as available liquidity in the USDC market, the health of your previous unpaid borrowings, etc. Once you successfully borrow USDC, the interest will start accumulating with each Ethereum block, so about every 13 seconds. The interest rates with the Compound protocol are floating, meaning the rate changes based on market conditions. More specifically, the rate changes anytime assets are added or removed from the Compound's USDC market. Aave, on the other hand, gives you an option to borrow either at a stable or floating interest rate. Utilization is a measure of what percentage of the funds in the market are available for borrowings and withdrawals. Generally, interest rates increase as the utilization of funds in the market increases, meaning as less and less funds are available to borrow or withdraw, it gets more and more expensive to borrow. This is defined by a curve and it does two things. It encourages borrowers to pay back their loans soon to avoid having to pay a high interest. And it incentivizes lenders to put more funds into the market to take advantage of the high interest rates. Taking either of these actions will bring more liquidity into the market and bring the utilization down. This is important because as utilization gets close to 100%, the market becomes illiquid, meaning there are no funds left to facilitate withdrawals or borrowings. The valuations of crypto assets can be very volatile. So, it is possible that the value of the loans taken by a user could collectively go over the collateral factor. If this happens, the borrowing account becomes insolvent. When an account becomes insolvent, other users can repay a portion of its outstanding borrow in exchange for a portion of its collateral. This is very important to make sure that loans taken by an account remain over-collateralized at all times. To that end, the DeFi protocols offer a liquidation incentive. This is basically a chance for anyone to buy some of the collateral at a discount. The discount can be different for different assets and across protocols. For example, the current discounts for ETH are 8% in Compound and 5% in Aave. The person fulfilling a liquidation could buy the collateral at an 8% discount to the current market price. Taking our previous example, say the value of ETH dropped significantly and the collateral ratio has raised to 80%, meaning if you borrowed 1000 USDC, there's only about $1,250 worth of Ether as collateral. The protocol could now sell some of that Ether at an 8% discount and bring down the remaining borrow to 300 USDC and collateral to $410 worth of Ether. Obviously, having your account liquidated is bad because you lose some of your collateral. So, it's important that users maintain a healthy collateral ratio across all borrowings. Advantages. There are several advantages to DeFi lending protocols over their CeFi counterparts, such as Trustless. DeFi lending runs using smart contracts with predefined rules. So, this eliminates the risks associated with trusted intermediaries, such as getting hacked, running away with your assets, or incorrectly closing out your positions. Accessible. DeFi protocols are accessible to everyone without the need for complicated signups. High exposure. Because DeFi protocols are highly accessible, you get exposure to a global audience. This unlocks more liquidity and new opportunities. Speed and efficiency. You can lend or borrow from a DeFi protocol in a matter of seconds. Compare that with the days or weeks it may take with some of the CeFi solutions. And a lot of other benefits that are inherent to smart contracts, such as interoperability, transparency and cost savings. Risks and disadvantages. You should also pay attention to the risks and disadvantages of DeFi lending, such as smart contract risks. DeFi lending protocols are basically just a set of smart contracts, so they always come with smart contract risk. As the sums of money locked in these protocols grow, they become targets for increasingly sophisticated attacks. Popular platforms like Aave and Compound employ techniques like extensive internal testing, external security audits, and formal verification to reduce this risk significantly. Liquidation risks. Most DeFi protocols rely on liquidation incentives to keep the loans over-collateralized at all times. During extreme market conditions, if the protocol couldn't liquidate the collateral fast enough, it will be exposed to under-collateralized borrowings. This can lead to unexpected losses that could be passed on to the lenders. Popular protocols generally benefit from a large community of users and bots to mitigate this risk. Interest rate uncertainty. The interest rates on DeFi protocols are determined by the utilization of funds in the market. During extreme scenarios, the interest rates could rise significantly. If you borrowed from this market and weren't paying attention, you're at the risk of getting liquidated because the borrowed amount plus interest accrued could quickly go over the collateral factor. This could make it hard to plan your finances using these loans. The stable interest rate option in protocols like Aave could be a good alternative for this. No under-collateralized loans. DeFi lending protocols currently do not offer under-collateralized loans. In certain CeFi offerings, users with good credit ratings could borrow without any collateral. And then there are other inherent issues of DeFi, such as rug pulls and scalability limitations of the blockchain on which the protocol is deployed. Most of these risks are well mitigated in protocols such as Aave and Compound. Users should do their own research when trying out new protocols. The whole DeFi space is evolving at a rapid pace. It's very exciting to see how DeFi protocols employ novel techniques to utilize the unique properties of blockchains and work around the limits of decentralized systems. I'll explore popular DeFi protocols in more detail in future videos, but for now, we're out of time.
So, what did you think about DeFi lending? Is this something you've tried or would like to try at some point? Let me know in the comments below. Thanks for watching. My name is Praveen, and I'll see you again in the next video.